Hey, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for joining us on another Try Science. Hopefully, camera's working here. If not, I'm here, trust me, and we are going to be talking about breathing. Here's a cool question. Why do we breathe? I know what you're thinking, to stay alive. But why? What does breathing do that keeps you alive? Have you ever thought through the whole reason why we breathe? And think about all the different reasons that we might breathe and what breathing does to your whole body. Let's check this out and see.
We take a breath every few seconds. Our life depends upon inhaling oxygen, but we never think about how we breathe. It just seems to happen automatically. How can something that seems so simple be the key to keeping us alive? Breathing starts with the environment around us. The air we breathe in or inspire has a mixture of gases, including nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and oxygen, which is the most important for our survival. It enters our body through the nose and mouth, moves down into the pharynx, trachea, and bronchial tubes, and ultimately reaches the alveoli air sacs in the lungs. The alveoli use pressure to move oxygen and nutrients into the blood. The diaphragm and intercostal muscles are a pumping system that facilitates this air exchange. How you breathe affects your energy level, especially when you are under physical or emotional stress. Think back to the last difficult test you had to take. It's likely that as you became more nervous, the tension in your body increased and your breathing quickly sped up. The shallower our breath, the less oxygen that reaches our brain, and the harder it is to focus. What's our response to physical stress, like a fast-paced game of field hockey after school? As we exert pressure on our bodies, the muscles require a great deal of energy and demand additional oxygen. Our panting breath starts to kick in, which creates pressure to draw in more air and oxygen to the body and regulates body temperature by allowing it to cool down naturally. These aren't the only times our breathing is affected or altered. Think about the last time you got angry or emotional. Anger creates a metabolic reaction in the body, which stresses it out and heats up our internal temperature. Have you ever seen anyone lose their cool? Ultimately, if we're breathing under stress over long periods of time, there are consequences. When the cells of the body aren't getting the oxygen they need, the nutrients available to the body decrease, and toxins build up in the blood. It is thought that a hypoxic or oxygen-poor environment can increase cancerous cells. The good news is that we can control our breath much more than we realize. This means we can increase both the quality and quantity of the breath. The science of breathing has been around for thousands of years, from ancient yogis in India to respiratory therapists working with patients today. Both would tell you that there are specific techniques that will help you improve your breathing. Breathing is all about moving air from a higher pressure to a lower pressure environment. More breath means more oxygen and ultimately a greater amount of nutrients that's available for our cells and blood. We naturally do this when we let out a big sigh. Changing the air pressure going into the lungs is one of the main ways to alter breathing. Our body automatically does this when we cough, sneeze, or have the hiccups. Here's a simple experiment. Close off your right nostril with your right thumb. Breathe in and out just through the left nostril. Notice how much harder it is to get the breath in. You have to focus your attention and use your diaphragm and muscles much more than normal. By decreasing the surface area of the airways, you are increasing the pressure of oxygen moving from the alveoli to the blood. Yogis often practice alternate nostril breathing to slow down the breath, increase oxygen, and activate the body's parasympathetic nervous system, which deals with the body's operations when it's at rest. Let's try another exercise. Visualize the way a dog pants when it breathes. Now try doing the same type of panting, first with your tongue out, then with your mouth closed. You will find yourself using your stomach muscles to push the air out as you exhale. Place your hand under your nose and you'll feel the strength of the breath coming out. Breathing this way is hard because it requires an active movement of our diaphragm and intercostal muscles. Our body temperature changes quickly during this exercise from the amount of pressure we are exerting on our breath. It's no surprise that you'll find dogs doing this breath often to cool down on a hot day. When we sleep at night, the medulla center of the brain makes sure that we keep breathing. Lucky for us, we don't have to think about it. During the day, our breath is much more vulnerable, especially under stressful or difficult situations. That's why it's helpful to pay attention to your breathing. If you can monitor and change your breath, you can improve both the quality and quantity of oxygen that enters your body. This lowers stress, increases energy, and strengthens your immune system. So the next time someone tells you to relax and take a deep breath, you'll know exactly why.
But I still want to know why we breathe. So our function of our respiratory system is to bring in oxygen and remove carbon dioxide. We probably knew that. But why? What does that do for our body? All right, guys, today you're going to need your note packet. Get your note packet out. Find the chart that says respiratory system. And then locate your larger packet. We're on page 8. Where we're going to learn a little bit more about why we need to breathe. All right, let's start with our function. To bring in oxygen and to remove CO2. Why do we need to bring in oxygen and remove CO2? That's the million-dollar question. Oh. These gases sound familiar to me. They're part of cellular respiration. What exactly was cellular respiration? Let's check it out.
Do you mind? I'm trying to concentrate on my breathing here. Dear Tim and Moby, is respiration the same thing as breathing? From Chad. I'm practicing deep breathing, but breathing and respiration are two different things. Breathing is part of the respiratory system, a group of organs that deliver oxygen from the air we breathe to cells throughout the body. Respiration, or cellular respiration to be exact, is what living cells do with that precious oxygen. Right, we all need oxygen to survive, but did you ever stop to wonder why? Yeah, that's what I thought. We use oxygen to process glucose, a simple sugar that provides all the energy cells need to function. All day long, your digestive system is busy breaking down food and turning it into glucose to power your cells. Glucose, along with oxygen from your lungs, is delivered to your cells through your bloodstream. Inside tiny cellular structures called mitochondria, these substances undergo a chemical reaction called respiration. When the reaction is complete, three things are left over: an energy-packed molecule called ATP, water, and the waste gas, carbon dioxide. Your cells expel the carbon dioxide into your blood, which carries it to your lungs. When you breathe out, you're exhaling this carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is a harmful waste gas that your body needs to get rid of. If too much carbon dioxide builds up in your blood, you die. Right, the ATP. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate, and cells use it to do everything that requires work. The energy in ATP lets cells synthesize complex organic molecules like DNA, RNA, and proteins. It powers the muscle contractions that let us move around. And lots more. That's true, cellular respiration isn't just for humans. You find it happening inside the cells of all living animals, and even plants. Another good point. Because it uses oxygen, cellular respiration is also called aerobic respiration. But what happens when there's no oxygen handy? Like when you're exercising really hard and your lungs can't supply your muscle cells with all the oxygen they need? In that case, the cells go with a backup plan called fermentation, where glucose is processed with carbon dioxide instead of oxygen. It doesn't make as much energy as aerobic respiration. But it works for a short time. This kind of respiration, in which something other than oxygen is used to release the energy from glucose, is called anaerobic respiration. Some organisms, like yeasts, use only anaerobic respiration for energy. Hey, are you even listening? Moby. Hey, Moby.
Hey, you listening out there? You paying attention? Watch it again. Go back and review. really, go back and review. That video had everything that we've done this year. Talking about cellular respiration, obviously, but how breathing is connected to things like the digestive system, which is providing the glucose for the cells in the mitochondria, where you have glucose, but you need oxygen. Why do you breathe? Your cells need oxygen to do cellular respiration. Without it, you have no energy. With no energy, you cannot be considered alive. And that's an important thing. And then they talked about CO2. Cellular respiration builds up CO2 as a byproduct. If you don't remove that from the body, that's a toxic poison. They talked about the muscles, the bones, mitosis. I mean, everything that bodies need energy for was part of that video. Please watch it 6 times. All right. Let's go on back to our notes. So our function is done. Let's talk about the different parts. You have a picture like I. Your nose and throat and mouth here are all connected, as you guys can see. And that is where air enters and exits the body. Fun fact, you have a nasal passage here, which is much larger than you might think to catch foreign bodies like bacteria, viruses, dust, and other pollutants in the mucus. Mucus is a really good, nice way to filter your air before it goes through onto the trachea. Now, the trachea sits next to the esophagus. And if you've ever swallowed food and it went down the wrong pipe, that wrong pipe is the trachea. This is a stiff tube held open by cartilage, so it's hard to pinch off. It's hard to stop someone from breathing, as it will allow the air to travel down through into the lungs. Now, you have two lungs, so you're going to need that tube to branch into two. And if we look closely at this picture, those branches continue to branch like a tree. So think branch. They continue to branch and branch and branch. If you'd like to find out more about alveoli on your own, look at the back of page 8 in your larger packet and see if you can come up with the basic function, what alveoli do, what they are. It's a new word. That sounds very strange. Back to bronchitis really quick. If you've had bronchitis, then you can tell it comes from this word, bronchioles, an infection of the bronchioles, or the tubes in your lungs that carry the air. Interesting, right? All right, pause, and then we'll go over alveoli. All right, welcome back. Let's see how you did on alveoli. Alveoli, as you can see in your picture on the back of page 8, are basically balloon-like structures in lungs where the gases exchange with the blood, means trade back and forth. This is the most important part of your lung. You want to think of your lung as like a big balloon, right, that inflates. That's not true. Your lung is more like a sponge with all these branches. And at the end, clusters of alveoli, which kind of look like a little bit like grapes or raspberry or something. And these are air pouches. Let's take a look. If we could see at a microscopic level, we would see an alveoli is a hollow space that allows air traveling down this bronchial tube to inflate these hollow spaces. Now, these red and blue lines here, those are the capillaries. They're tiny, tiny blood vessels, and they carry the oxygen that you get from your lung into the blood and throughout to the body. So it's going to work something like this. As you breathe in oxygen-rich air, it's going to pressurize and actually go through the wall of the alveoli and the blood vessel. These are one cell thick. These are small. And there are plenty of spaces for the oxygen to travel through. This is a red blood cell. It picks up and carries oxygen and then travels because of the heartbeat all throughout your body, where it can deliver oxygen to cells that need it. Okay, and then it eventually will come back to the lungs. Now, they're colored in blue here to remind us that they have low levels of oxygen, and they have high carbon dioxide levels. Carbon dioxide will exchange from the blood through these walls into the air sac, and when you breathe out, much of that carbon dioxide will leave your body. How amazing! This is where the respiratory system and the cardiovascular system, the blood and heart work together. Now, real blood isn't really blue, but we're using it in our diagram to show that it has low oxygen. And the last thing we need to know is, what is the diaphragm? A muscle that controls breathing, found at the bottom of your chest cavity. As it contracts down, air is pulled in. As it relaxes up, air is pushed out. If you are in chorus or band or play a musical instrument where you have to blow into it, you know about your diaphragm muscle. Athletes have to control their diaphragm and control their breathing to maximize their efforts. So that is our introduction to the notes. Make sure you get diaphragm. Okay, let's talk about some of the fun facts over here. We need to breathe because our cells need oxygen, because cellular respiration is happening in every cell of your body. The lungs are basically spongy organs filled with tubes, microscopic alveoli, and blood vessels. Your lungs can hold a lot of air. Well, it turns out each lung can hold about 1 liter of air on average. Now, athletes or musicians might be able to increase that just through practice and breathing. The respiratory system works closely with other body systems like your digestive system and cardiovascular to help provide that energy that our bodies need. All right, let's do a quick review and then we'll call it a wrap.
Can't do it. Dear Tim and Moby, why do we breathe from men? Hey, you're talking about the respiratory system. We have to breathe to live, but I bet most people don't know exactly why. Your body can store up a lot of the nutrients it needs, but it can't store the one thing that you need all the time. An invisible gas called oxygen. Inside your body, oxygen allows all your cells to make energy so they can function properly. Since you can't store it, your body takes it in all the time in a process called breathing. Breathing is the main function of the respiratory system, which in complex animals is responsible for carrying air to the lungs. Here's how it works in humans. Everyone has two lungs in their chest. Your lungs are surrounded by your rib cage, and they rest on a dome-shaped muscle called the diaphragm. Every time you take a breath, the diaphragm contracts and moves downward, and your rib cage expands. This causes a drop in air pressure inside your lungs, which the higher pressure air from outside rushes in to equalize. When you inhale, air enters your body through your nose or your mouth. It travels down the trachea or windpipe to your lungs. Inside the lungs, air moves into smaller and smaller passages called bronchial tubes. Eventually, the air spreads to the alveoli. The alveoli are tiny sacs surrounded by blood vessels called capillaries. Oxygen moves through the walls of the alveoli and capillaries and into the blood. Well, the alveoli and capillary walls are only like one cell thick, so it's pretty easy. Oh no, there's more. When your lungs take oxygen in, they send carbon dioxide out. Carbon dioxide is a harmful waste gas that you have to get rid of. It's made in your cells and travels through the blood into your heart, which pumps it back into capillaries around your alveoli. Your diaphragm relaxes and moves upward, which deflates your lungs and makes you exhale this used air. And so on. That's breathing. That's pretty close, Moby. Our lungs don't fly around the room or anything, but they do inflate and deflate, just like a balloon. I'd say breathing is pretty important. You want to do all you can to keep your lungs in good working order. Regular exercise helps keep your lungs in shape. And you should steer clear of things that are bad for your lungs, like smoking. Smoking damages your cilia, little hairs inside your bronchial tubes that help remove unwanted matter from the lungs. In the long term, smoking can give you lung cancer and emphysema, a disease that makes it difficult to breathe. Right, and you should avoid air pollution too. And toxic waste. And poisonous gas. I think they get the point.
Yes, protect your lungs, guys. They're so important. Next lesson, we'll talk a little bit more about the dangers of inhaling things that you shouldn't be, and we'll talk about how to protect those healthy lungs and keep them healthy. Hey, thanks so much for joining us on Try Science, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Check Schoology. Bye for now.